The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
I think even before we begin the message, I want to cover what God has clearly spoken for the new year so you can prepare your hearts, and we'll give you details as the weeks unfold. Yeah, and also pray for us this week. Jason will be doing the Tuesday night service here, but we'll be leaving Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. We'll be coming back Thursday. We're doing a Tuesday, Wednesday meeting in Baltimore. Keep us in prayer there. They have guest speakers come in on a regular basis, and we'll be going this week. These are people that, pastors that we met when we were in Israel. And after us, they'll have some people from Sid Roth speaking. After them, they'll have Catherine Ruanala from Australia will be speaking there, as well as others. So anyway, pray for us for this week. Also, we've got people from that general Baltimore area that'll be coming as well that know us from various ways and means. But here's the exciting part. Here's what was happening. And God told me about this a long time ago, but I put stuff on a shelf until it's the right time. Now exactly is the time, and I am positive of the timing. One thing I'm confident in is timing. You can get revelation and sometimes sit on revelation for a long time and know that it's right, but you don't do nothing and you don't try to make it happen, all right? But this is clearly the time, and here's the word too, and it's gonna be a little bit of a new wineskin in and of itself because you've probably not heard of this, but everybody's heard of home groups, right? But God laid it on my heart that around the world, nationally and internationally, we've got people who see themselves as spiritual sons and daughters. So they're connected to Jennifer and I as sons and daughters. You understand? Not just people that want to join something. They feel like they caught the heart of our message and want to reproduce that message. Now, they have various giftings. So what the Lord laid on my heart was that we're going to have house groups. Matter of fact, Jason's going to start his house group this the first, third, and possibly fifth Thursday of the month. And it will coincide when we're not doing something here Tuesday, because we'll be videotaping on the first, third, and fifth Tuesdays of every month. So he's going to have his on Thursday. Now that's a house group. Everybody knows what a house group is. Okay. But God says, based on various people's giftings and their leanings, we're going to have house groups, and we already have some of these house churches that are under Full Stature. Full Stature is the umbrella over Kingdom Life Church and over the school, Team Embassy. So if you picture Full Stature, that's the more international ministry. People go to our website, they go to Full Stature Ministries. All right. House churches, house schools. These are people that just feel like, I'm more of a teacher than a pastor, and I want to teach this material, whether it's to children, adults, or whoever. And we'll have house schools, house churches, house groups, house outreaches. This is interesting. There are people who are more evangelistically oriented, but even if you're evangelistically oriented toward outreach, you're still supposed to disciple. You're not just supposed to win somebody to the Lord and then let them go, right? So discipleship should be in a true outreach, but many people are very, very comfortable with one-on-one ministry. And I know of people that are ministering to as many as 20 people, but it's pretty much on a one-on-one. You know, they have children, and these people have children, and they get together when they can get together. It's not a formal get-together, but they're consistently ministering to people and discipling them in an outreach. But it's connected to us. This is sons and daughters. There is, of course, for this to take place. Now, I just touched on it last Sunday. I was getting text messages during the message. That's me. That's me, Pastor. It was coming from Missouri, Florida, California, North Dakota. That's me. That's me. They've been connected by Ustream and primarily just feel like that's my DNA. And many of them are probably in the school. I don't know who's in the school and who's connected. But there's many people that they're taking our material. There's even a house school in Missouri that basically is taking the Live Free series and walking a group through it progressively. So that's more of a house school. But the good news is you don't get hung up on house school, house outreach, house group, because they can change. A house group could become a house church, you know. So it's flexible, but I want to show that there's something that God is doing in the small group. And these small groups, I believe when the Spirit of God and an awakening happens, these small groups are going to be united by a relationship that's deeper than sitting in a group church type setting. You know people in the small better than you'll ever know. Even for as tiny as we are, you still don't know the people as much as you would in a house group setting. And that's really where the koinonia and the relationship takes place. And quite frankly, things get difficult, I want to be with people that know me. I want to be with people that have relationship with me, that don't just know me to see my face, but they know me by the Spirit, not just according to the flesh. And so what we're looking for in the days ahead is developing this. And I'll be going over this with our pastors. And we're going to be, because the need is there. And then after God puts this download that now is the time for this, I've had this on my heart for some time. But after he said that, I saw a little YouTube video with Lance Wallnau. And I got excited. So I threw it on, I don't know what I'm doing on Facebook. Don't, please ignore most of what I do. I just share. I know how to do that part. So anyway, and I can click on like. I know how to do that too. But that's about the extent of it. Anything else, if they ask me questions, they start typing me stuff. I go, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how to answer that. But anyway, he did a thing that he released that word on, and his word was micro. And God told me all along that when Jennifer and I met, that he put the two of us together, his presence ushered into the room, and we both blurted out at the same time, because we were just soaking, and we both blurted out a scripture. I said, this is where two or more. And Jennifer said, this is one accord. And God is saying, it only takes two or three to bring the presence of God, and where two or more, I'll be in the midst. And I believe there's going to be little micro upper rooms all around the world, and then the glory of the Lord is going to cover the earth as the water cover the sea. It's not going to take the old wineskin method. It's beautiful to have crusades of 6,000 people and 10,000 people, but in the nitty-gritty of Christian life and in the early church, they met house to house. And I'm telling you, it's going to return to that. And there might even be a reason that it needs to return to that, because it's going to need the stability and the security. Did you know that even in the world, whether it's AA or those other organizations, if it wasn't for the fact that they had sponsors, some of those people wouldn't have made it. That's how important people are. God's in the people business. And I know God's saying now's the time. And now's the time, but it's happening before I'm announcing it, because we've already got house schools, we've already got around the country and outside of the country, because we've got the precious couple from South Korea and the Moons, and they're doing a beautiful work in South Korea, so it's already international. But the point is, there is a connection. And we'll get into some of the details, and people can inquire of the details later. I don't want to go into it too much. But the fact of the matter is, it's primarily knowing that this is not just a fellowship group. This is a group that is going to disciple people. This is a group that's on a mission, and the family mission, and they catch the family mission. And it's not just about me getting help. It's about me helping other people. And we're going to see it multiply, and it's going to catch. I mean, we're getting children that are basically catching this and working with other children and helping other children. there's going to be a generation that's going to rise up that's going to be so intimate with God that they're going to wonder what the rest of the church is doing. They just look religious because they're going to know him intimately. And so as these things begin to happen and unfold, be prepared that this is it. So house outreaches are what? Basically people that like to minister on a one-to-one without a formal meeting. But they could have a formal meeting. But they're ministering to people in the marketplace even. I know it's, I really see even, for instance, really what you're doing at work, just ministering at work to different people. Some of those people are going to go to Baltimore. We're going to be in Baltimore. We get to meet some of the people that you're working with in a business setting. So it's kind of like it doesn't have to be in these house groups can also be taking place in the marketplace. I had my first Bible study in an office building where people just knew that there was a handful of Christians at lunchtime that wanted to just meet together, and we did it that way too. But these little groups still need more than just fellowship. They need purpose, and that's the distinctive difference, because we've got a purpose, we've got tools, we've got ability to help people quickly, and that what needs to be reproduced. That is going to go worldwide. Destiny Image also has asked us to do two more books. And we'll get into that at a later date too, but anyway, yes. Oh my goodness, we got one. I could spend the whole service just explaining the different groups and where they're at in the country and what they're doing, and it's remarkable the amount of reproduction. So to me, this is going to be the era of, if you want to call it the house church, the house school, the house outreach, the house group. It can be any of those things, but there's one thing in common. It's not just there for fellowship. It's not just there to yuck it up with each other. It's going to be to on purpose disciple people to get rid of the baggage in their life and move forward into the plans and the purposes of God, which leads me into our message for today. Isn't that convenient? It just worked right in there. All right, today's message, are you ready, camera guy? Okay. today's message is basically spiritual sanity, or we could say spiritual insanity. Which one would you prefer? Spiritual sanity, all right? So let's just begin right there. Father, I believe that we're taking these people in a new direction. There's a new flow of the river, and there's a new flow of anointing. And God, we want to follow your flow for the days ahead, because you're bringing about change. You're causing us to flow in new wine, and the new wine belongs in a new wineskin. So we will see you hand in hand begin to move in such a way that we are willing to let go of where we've been so thoroughly entrenched. That is a clear word. When I came to North Carolina, probably 19 years ago, a prophet, I think it was Randy Lechner, wasn't it, Jennifer? I don't remember. And we were down in Georgia, Jennifer and I were in Georgia, and he prophesied. He said, did you not know that I had to remove you from where you were so thoroughly entrenched? I never knew I was entrenched. And that opens my eyes that a lot of people don't know what they're entrenched in. But you know, I knew where I went to the grocery store in Pennsylvania. I knew where I got my hair cut. I knew what pastors I met with during the week. I knew this. I knew. You don't realize you can get secure in your surroundings to such a degree that you don't move in the cadence when God tells you to move. God tells you to make a change. You look for your comfort. And that's why there will always be difficulty moving from an old wineskin to a new wineskin, because I've seen women in abusive situations that thought in their head they ought to get out of that relationship, but they got so comfortable in the familiar that they're afraid of change. So if it can be that extreme, then don't you think we could be guilty of some of that ourselves? That there's certain things in our comfort zone that God wants to change or rearrange, and we don't want to do it? So I'm just saying that basically we need to start back and get into the Spirit of God, into reality. Spiritual sanity versus spiritual insanity. And there is spiritual insanity. But let's start with the beginning. John 18, verse 37. For this reason, this is good reasoning now. This is for this reason. This is Jesus speaking. For this reason I was born, and for this reason I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Truth, obviously, versus the lie, and mental or spiritual insanity, to me, would be the devil. That's the easiest description of spiritual insanity, would be the lie or the devil, because he's a liar from the beginning. That's his very nature. There's no truth in him. There's no light in him. So he's the perfect example of spiritual insanity. Spiritual sanity is Jesus, who says, I am the truth, and for this reason I came. Truth and reality are synonymous. Say that back to me. Truth and reality are synonymous. That's spiritual sanity. That's having the mind of God. That's having a spiritual worldview. And Jesus said, this is the reason that I was born, and for this reason that I come into the world, to testify to that reality. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Didn't he say that? I am the reality. Your reality and spiritual sanity depends on your knowledge of reality, not your opinions. And he says, everyone on the side of this reality, or everyone on the side of truth, listens to me. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. And every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes it away. He prunes. Pruning is a good thing. It's bringing about some, getting rid of some baggage and unnecessary things so that you could bear more fruit. I am totally convinced that there is a pruning going on, that people are being disappointed, discouraged, thinking God's not there, and in reality, they're playing right into the hands of spiritual insanity. You're playing right into the hands of the liar and the father of lies, because I'm saying that this is the time to move toward recognizing, I don't really need that. I don't really have to do that. I don't really need, that's not my security. My security's in him, all right? Because it's a time of pruning, but the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. You've got to get reconnected to that truth, that reality. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you abide in me, you're going to bear much fruit. And then the last statement, to me, is a reminder. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That's a little reality therapy for the average Christian, because a lot of Christians think they don't even ask God for help because they think, I can do that. And that might be part of your getting off course, thinking you can do that and only ask God for the hard stuff. You need to be asking God for everything, because apart from him, you really can't do nothing, or the things you do really aren't going to amount to anything. They're going to be like dead works. So in the beginning, God created matter, energy, space, and time. This is Jennifer's stuff. She likes this. Matter, energy, space, and time. So figure God created all of this stuff. And the people who live apart from the reality in Jesus are actually saying, and this is spiritual insanity, God is not. And they live in a box, and believe it, listen in the church, because you're going to start hearing this stuff in the church. That, and they say it with our constitution. They say it's a living document, it changes. They're going to say the church is a living organism, it changes with time and with culture. No, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change. All right, but people are trying to get you into relativism, and that relativism, or when truth or their reality is relative, that truth, they're saying that truth changes with culture. Truth does not change with culture. Truth is supposed to impact culture. And that's where you have to get to, where my reality is to impact their illusion. So God's basically saying, this created universe and their little cube of what you see around you is basically the illusion. The reality is outside of this. Do you believe God lives outside of that little cube of his created universe? He created it, so he's outside of it. but he's in authority over it. There's nothing that happens in there that he doesn't have authority over. So men have actually gone into the spiritual insanity of making idols. They've made a false god out of human reasoning. Or they say, like I learned in college, the first thing that taught us in social science was, I am God. And some later changed that to, there is no God, which still makes you God, because you're the one that decided that there was no God. So even Christians live as though God is not. And this is what I believe is going to be changing. It's insanity. Insanity is when you lose touch with reality. Isn't that the definition of insanity? At some level, natural, but I'm talking in the spirit realm. When you lose touch with that intimate relationship with God, you're moving into a whole realm that is dangerous. That reasoning mind wars against reality. And insanity is believing that the lie is real. Think about that in the natural, and think about it in the spiritual. Believing the lie is real. And if you believe the lie is real, and this is something I want to see people do, is Christ, this is Colossians 2, Christ himself, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with persuasive arguments. Facebook is not the place for you to resolve your politics or your theology. Oh, dear Lord. There's people who go, oh, that is so good. 90 people say, oh, that is great. And it's not even scriptural. That's what scares me about Facebook. It's like these are people just put their opinions out there, and it's like scary sometimes. Yeah, that's right. And I'm going, oh, my goodness. Who's your pastor? Ask your pastor that question first before you get all excited. But anyway, that's neither here nor there, because they will continue to do that. How many are familiar with Facebook? Hey, there's everything on there, from how to make sweet sticky buns to corruption in politics. I mean, you could find anything there. Some people should stick to how to make sticky buns and stay away from the religion and the politics. It gets a little scary. But anyway, in order that no one may delude you with persuasive argument will always be there, and people will always be able to make a case for the lie. But here's the common insanity, and here's what I believe God's dealing with in believers. And this is part of the change that's going to take place before we can go into the new. This is common Christian spiritual insanity, and Jesus laid it out in Matthew 6. Therefore, you're not going to like this. Go like this. If you can't handle it, write it down and then meditate on it later. Therefore, I tell you, this is God, all right? Do not worry about your life. How many people are guilty already? What about me? What's happening to me? Last year, blah, 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 blah. Do you know what you're saying when you do that? When you're worrying about your life, when you are disappointed with how things went last year and everything that happened last year, you are basically have entered into the unreality and spiritual insanity. You're already entering into the reasoning mind and the lie of the enemy. You are coming against the very nature and the character of what God says. God clearly says, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, drink, or about your body, what you're going to wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more than clothes? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes, seeing how the lilies of the field grow? God's going to take care of you. If that's how God clothes the grass, which is here today and gone tomorrow, how much more will he clothe you? You know what he basically says? When you start leaning into that mentality, oh, you of little faith, you're already backsliding from reality. Seek first the kingdom, and all these things will be given unto you. I once was young and now I am old, and I've never seen the righteous begging bread. The righteous won't be begging bread. There needs to be a course adjustment in everybody's life. Because if you are fulfilling the lordship of Jesus in every area of life, you're not going to be left alone. That's believing the lie. That's coming totally against the nature of God. Whether you say you're a Christian born again or not, you're coming against what God says. That worry, that anxiety, you're saying that that is real and not Jesus. So do you believe God is or he is not? Really, is what it amounts to. Do you believe he is or he is not? Because God created that cosmic universe, and he dwells outside. He has dominion over it. He's absolute, and he is reality. But what if you're saying, God is not there for me? God will not provide for me? God does not have the answers. God does not have a plan for me. God is not the ultimate authority. I can't trust God. He is not. God will not tell me what to do. You're in spiritual insanity, and you could be going to church and living in spiritual insanity if you're saying those things, because that is clearly the lie. If you say you believe but you don't live it, then you don't really believe it. It's not what you say with your mouth, it's what you live. I think Kenan had something. I like Kenan Bridges. I like to read stuff that he posts. And he posted, quoting the scriptures is not the same as living the scriptures. Right? Quoting it's not the same as living it. We are good at quoting, professing, and confessing it, but living it's a whole nother matter. You can say it until the cows come home, but if you're not living it, what difference does it make? It's not going to change anything. It's lip service. And here's where the Lord convicted me for the new year. The Lord said, even though, and he did this at perfect timing, he did this after he gave me a tremendous download of what he wanted done for this year. So what happens when you get a download? I know that I know, right? And then as soon as I said, I know that I know, and he goes, you're right, but, that got my attention, right? He took me to Revelations 3 and he says, these things says, amen, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know your works and that you're neither hot nor cold, and I wish you were cold or hot. I just got a download. I thought it was pretty hot. And he says, no, you're lukewarm. I'll vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say, and at first I was going to argue with it. At first you say, I'm rich, wealthy, I have need of nothing. And he says, and you do not know that you're wretched, miserable, poor, and blind. And so I started saying, you know what? I am wretched, miserable, poor, and blind because I want ISAV. I want to repent and change garments because if I want to get more of God, I've got to start from the place of repentance. Repentance is a change of clothes. It's putting on the garments. He says, you need to get garments from me. You think you're clothed. I say you're naked. You think you're rich. I say you need wisdom and the true treasures from me. You think you see, and I'm telling you, you need eye salve. I want to give you revelation. And by humbling yourself, I believe he gave even further insight into those things. But it was important for me to say, if we're going to change and move into this new year, we need to get to the point where we don't think we've arrived. We don't think we've got enough information. Because I've watched that in the church, even with leaders, work against God doing a new thing. Why is there old wineskins attack new wineskins? Because a lot of times they're threatened. They got secure in the old wineskin, and God forbid somebody changes the wineskin. They get threatened. The tendency will be to attack it. But actually what God's saying is because they think you're rich and you have it together, you don't realize you're miserable, naked, and blind because I'm moving in a different direction and you can't even tell. You can't even see your provision. You can't see the provision that's right in front of you. And some of your provision is not comfortable. God moves you into a place of discomfort and you call that punishment when God's basically saying it's pruning and positioning for the greater fruit in your life. But belly aching, worrying, and being disappointed, you will miss the provision that's right in front of your eyes based on your own reasoning mind. So God basically is saying, let's just start right there. The Father, if we think And people do this in church too. They go, oh, I already knew that. I already knew that. Well, don't even go there. I already knew that. There's so much more to know that we don't know. Let's just go there. God, I want to open up to a spirit of revelation. Just as blue as the sky is, I want the blueness of revelation for the days ahead. I want the guidance and the intimacy, and I want eyesalve for my eyes. I want to see what you want me to see. I only want to do what I see my Father doing. I only want to say what I hear my Father saying. I want to be clothed in your righteousness with your robes. I don't want to be naked and covered in my own worry and concern, but I want to be covered by your plans and your purposes. And we repent and welcome a change of clothes that we haven't arrived yet, and we're preparing ourselves for 2016 and for the things that you want to do in a new way. Use me in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now here, I want to conclude with this. There's four appointments. I preached this over the years again and again, but I'll tell you, there's never been a more important time to get this across than now. And if you're watching by Ustream, I would take these 4 points. If you don't remember anything else in this message, take these 4 points because they apply to absolutely every believer. Note takers, or if you're not a note taker, maybe this would be a good time to start being a note taker, because this is not going to go away. This is a pattern based on a principle that God works. And if you choose to not be comfortable with his pattern, then you're probably going to stay behind. The first thing that has to be understood, the first thing, there's 4 statements that are going to be with appointed by God. There has been appointed by God an eternal plan. There is an appointed eternal plan. An appointed. Now, if you're going to enter into reality, you've got to say that God's word is true and that he said, I have a plan before the foundation. If you don't believe that, you can just go do your own thing, because you can't trust God. You can't be intimate with God. You can't be faithful. But he said, I have an appointed plan. And I always liked, Pastor Cliff always used to like to bring that in from the message about doing one big change that has to take place, and yet it's so simple. God has an overall plan for planet Earth. God is working to accomplish something without your permission even. And here's the hard part. It's not about you and your interpretation of your circumstances. It's not about you. You have been given a privilege. Write that word in all capitals. Privilege. You've been given a privilege to enter into God's plan. I'm telling you, you'd be surprised how many people have to switch that. I don't care how long you've been saved. You switch it. You're still looking at it. Why isn't God blessing me and my endeavors? I'll tell you why he's not blessing you and your endeavors, because you haven't wholeheartedly offered your body toward him and his endeavors. You're not entering into the God story. You're trying to get God to enter into your story. It's not going to work. It's not about what you want. It's about the fact that God has a plan, and he's giving you the privilege of entering into that plan. I'll tell you what, I'm a mere pastor. I didn't pick the vision God gave me, but I've given a vision. You have an option to get into that plan or not. There's a lot of people say, well, you can't follow a man, you can't follow that pastor. I'm following a plan. I didn't pick the plan. I get a kick out of this. People think it's like my idea. God says, I'm going to do this, and I don't know about you, but I'm going to jump in with both feet. God wants to replicate and disciple believers to full stature. He wants them to grow up instead of being weak, dependent on other people. He appointed a plan, but it's not about him blessing your plans or your good ideas or what you like or what you don't like. You've been given the privilege to enter into what God is doing. Point one. That could be radical. Some of you just need to take that to prayer, because if you don't start there, what good is the other stuff? Really? No. I have this plan, and why didn't God come through? That's the problem. It was your plan. God has a plan. There's no such thing. He didn't make any of you failures. He made all of you for success. I know the plans that I have for you, plans for welfare, not calamity. If you're in calamity, you did it. All right. That in itself, listen to this. This is the scripture he gave me from the time I was a baby Christian. Why I want to see changed lives. I couldn't live without change. I don't care about teaching and preaching if people's lives don't change. If they're not affected, I could care less. I'd quit in a blink of an eye. But I've seen my whole life people who have changed, who have went from one level to the next level. The purpose is, this is Ephesians 3, verses 10 and 11 in the Phillips translation, as far as being appointed an eternal plan. This is the verse that just gets me excited, always has. This is purpose. This is written on the tablet of my heart. The purpose is that all the angelic powers should see the manifold wisdom of God's eternal plan being worked out through the church in conformity to that timeless purpose which he centered in Jesus. In other words, the word is makarios. Manifold actually means like multicolored. God's purpose was that through church, people, not a building, church, through church, they would display to principalities and powers Jesus, the manifold wisdom of Jesus through unique colors, giftings, variety, manifold, many colored, many variegated, like shining light through a prism. All that beautiful rainbow colors is being displayed in heaven to principalities and powers, to angels, to demons, to everyone in the spirit realm viewing it, including unsaved people in the world. You demonstrate the wisdom of God. That wisdom is going to be in the unity and diversity of expression at the same time. That's the eternal plan. God wants to use you to display his glory to principalities and power and say, that's my church. But that church is basically the bride, which is displaying Jesus. That's the eternal plan. That's your purpose. How many have struggled, been in the church for years, don't know what their purpose is? Your purpose is to display Jesus. Well, that's not comfortable. I want a ministry. I know. That character stuff is a real pain. Yeah, I got to act like Jesus. I got to talk like Jesus. I got to act like a Christian. Are you ready for the second one? If you don't do the first one, you're not ready for the second one. You ready for the second one? So you've already repented, and you said, I want to be part of God's story. My individual life. I'm telling you, this will usher you into a new wineskin and fulfillment as a believer, because there are many people that are still, as much as they love the Lord and as long as they've been in the church, they're still kind of like shipwrecked. They're kind of floating around. This is the time for God, and Jennifer prophesied it. Basically, this is the time where he's bringing divine appointments, are coming into divine connections. You've made some connections, and you say, these are godly relationships, and now he's orchestrating them. He's putting them in divine order, ultimately for his divine purpose. So it's very clear he works according to a pattern based on a principle. But now here's the second one. You might not like this. I didn't like this. There is an appointed place for you. You don't pick and choose your place. God picks and chooses your place. Acts 17, verse 26, particularly in the New International Version, when I came and I left everything familiar at great loss. I've done it. My son Jason's done it when he came from Kansas. You leave everything that you had, everything that you knew, everything you're familiar with. Grow up. Quit being such a baby. I'm going to have this and I got to have that. I got to have this. I got to have that. You leave everything and say, God, be there for me. I drove down here and basically had a person roll down a car window when I was going to ask for directions, say, God's had me sitting in this car knowing you were going to come. I'll tell you what, I wouldn't trade that for the world. I wouldn't trade that step of obedience and watch the supernatural provision of God for all the comfort I had back in Pennsylvania, where I had at least a half a dozen pastors that I could meet with on a weekly basis. I could have went and asked them. I could have done this. I could have done that. I could have lived on Easy Street. But if you don't realize that you need to ask God, where do you want me? And he told me, Charlotte. And then for confirmation, I had so many confirmations that I was embarrassed that I needed that much confirmation. I'm in a strange person. I had a Russian missionary walk up to me and quote Acts 17. God just wants me to tell you that he's appointed the exact time and the exact place in which you should live. And he's done that for you too, because that's an eternal plan. This is not for Dennis. This is for you, that God has appointed the exact time and the exact place in which you should live. Now, if you have a better idea, Jeremiah 17 says, cursed is a man that trusts in himself, trusts in man, and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. He'll be like a shrub in the desert. Do you know any? Have any friends that are like shrubs in the desert? Highly gifted, but they're just like tumbleweeds. They're still looking for, where do I fit? They're still going to California on their Harley trying to find themselves. They're still, whatever they're doing, and then they get to California, they still got the Harley, they're still themselves. They look in the mirror, oh, God, I didn't change. But God basically saying they'll be like trees, and here's the part that always bothered me. They will inhabit the parched places. They'll be dry, uninhabited. But the funny thing is they won't see, they will not see good when it's right there. Their provision, because in that spiritual insanity of doing it your own way blinds you to the provision. I can remember having God tell me, I had a young protege, potential to be a protege, and God says, tell them that unless he gets a job, even part-time, if he does, gets a part-time job, rather than just living free off of us, I will pour into him everything I know as a pastor and mentor him and bring him into the fullness. And you know that part-time job? I'm out of here. I'm going to go find somebody that'll take care of me for free. But God says that's the test. You test the deacons. That's scriptural. You have to test. And you'd be surprised how many people flunk the test because they want absolutely no inconvenience. They want a one-way relationship. Take care of me. They will never enter into the full calling that God has for them because their center, their first appointed eternal plan is not, it's theirs, not God's. And they're looking out for how does this affect me instead of how can I fulfill the purposes of God? How can God use me to fulfill his purposes? How can I enter into the God story instead of my story? God basically said, there's an appointed place, and God, where God plants you, you will grow. And you may not want, I'm getting a prophetic word. Yeah, I thought I communicated that. Jennifer says, you didn't communicate the price that you really paid. Most people wouldn't have done what you did. I was in total obscurity, total isolation, no friends, no work, but God was there. And it wasn't that easy in the early years, even in Charlotte. It seemed like if you made a friend, they moved. It was like, God, what's going on? And yet, this is my jurisdiction. Bailiwick means your neck of the woods, your jurisdiction. And I know that this was the headquarters for what God is doing worldwide right now. I am so glad that I didn't figure it out, that I just obeyed him. I thought we were going to Nashville. I thought maybe we were going to Florida. I thought we were going to go to move to New England. I pull out of my subdivision that I could walk to from here, pull out, and God showed me a sign for this little building right here. So I knew it wasn't going to be a big church. A little building, and he says, there's your relocation. Yeah. And I don't advertise myself. I don't call pastors. I know some people do that. That's their business between them and God. I don't call pastors. Can I speak? I never promoted myself, and basically, we had to go all the way to New England to get work. Right? You go where the work's at. But I lived in Charlotte. 6 months out of the year we spent in New England. Lived in Charlotte, didn't know anybody in Charlotte. If you made a friend, they moved. Isolation. And it was the perfect will of God. Perfect will of God. People will look at convenience. You should be ashamed of really how much you look toward convenience. The will of God is ultimately never going to disappoint you. Never. You'll be disappointed in your figuring it out, but he's got a plan that's so superior to anything you could come up with. He will never leave you nor forsake you. But you've got to die to that thinking. You've got a better idea. There's an appointed place. Are you in the right place at the right time? One of the saddest stories we had a guy that says he was teaching the men in his church somewhere, I don't know, about 20 miles from here. He was teaching the men. God spoke to me clearly, he said. I'm supposed to come here and be discipled by you, but I can't leave those five men that I teach. Then what does that mean? He didn't listen to what God had to say. He had a need to be needed, and that weighed more than being obedient to God. Don't ever do that one. Don't ever do that one. Isn't that sad? That's saying, you know what? You need them more than they need you. I doubt if you're really doing anything for them. You're too needy yourself. You need to deal with that internal need of why you are codependent. Not really. Slightly. But that's not ministering to people. That's not life. But I'll tell you what, and Jennifer used to tell God that he had it wrong, and he never listened to her. She'd say, why do we live in Charlotte in the summertime and go to New England for 6 months in the wintertime? She's telling God had it backwards. But he never listened to her. We did that for 10 years, 10 or 12 years. He never listened to her. Guess what? He had a different plan. But did he bless it? Absolutely. And we saw the hand of God, everything we touched. That's why I think there's some people, they say, I have difficulty trusting God. You have difficulty trusting God because you've never really allowed him in the hard places to prove himself. He will prove himself, but if you only take the easy way all the time and the guaranteed ways and the assured ways and all of those steps, you'll never know. And you will always stay there. I had one verse of scripture, two. The first one was, go to the city of Nain, which was south of whatever city. I don't remember. It was on a little map in the Bible and the scripture. And I looked on the map, and it looked like south of Charlotte. So I thought, okay. So all I knew was Charlotte. Got off at exit one and got lost. Guy rolled down his window. God's had me sitting in this car, saying that someone was going to come and ask the directions. And it was supernatural like that from that day on, including having probably a $1,500 a month furnished apartment free on the lake. Next door neighbor was a medical doctor going through a hard time in his life and going through a divorce. And God gave me a first. I never had that back in Pennsylvania. None of my friends would have given me that. But a total stranger was obeying God. It's not easy, but it's glorious. It's not easy, but it's better than anything you could get on your own and in your own strength. So there's an appointed place. I believe there's people watching by Ustream that they're in the place that God's called them, whether it's Missouri, Kansas, Arkansas, Oklahoma, South Korea. But they felt like the next step has taken place in their life. And that is, there is the third appointment is an appointed people. This is scriptural. This is not my idea. This is not a pastor's idea to get people. Actually, I'm more accused of kicking people out. Right, Glenn? You've been with me the longest. Every month or two, I go, tomatoes belong in tomato patches and potatoes in potato patches. If you're a potato and you're in a tomato patch, you're going to be real uncomfortable. All right? And so if you're not real stable, you go, geez, I must be in the wrong place. I don't know why I'm coming here. I think he's telling me to leave. I don't know what he's doing. But in reality, you should have the kind of insurance that you feel, I got that DNA. This is home. This feels good. This feels right. This is what I feel God saying to me. If not, go somewhere else. Really, obey God. Gee. But God sets the solitary in families. And I'll tell you what. I have a real soft spot for singles because I think what singles need more than anything is family. And God has a plan. It's his idea. It's not my idea. It's not a churchy idea. It's a God idea. He places the solitary in families. Why? Why does he set you in a family? Of course, this family, it requires you to open up and have a two-way relationship with the family. All right? And in doing so, and that can be the problem with some single people, they don't want to open up relationally. They got used to their independence. I made a couple of them so mad that they reminded me of it for years later. I used an expression, self-absorbed single. You see, there are, everybody remember that, self-absorbed single people. And I love single people, so don't throw stuff at me. Self-absorbed simply means that you could very easily have got comfortable in being your own boss, doing what you want to do, in your own time, in your own way, until you have kids. And then your whole world turns upside down until you get married. And then there's this other person who throws stuff on the floor. What's this toothpaste doing squirting all over the bathroom? Say, who did? I never did that. Right? All of a sudden, there is a new reality. So self-absorbed single people, you can be a self-absorbed married person too, but obviously self-absorbed doesn't mean that you're just this bad person, but you've got accustomed to a comfort of being alone, nobody bothering you, doing what you want to do when you want to do it. You have no idea how many people can't do that. That's a different reality. But I'm telling you, God's plan for single people is he takes the solitary and he puts them in a family for relational purposes, for them to have somebody to bounce things off of. He brings them out who are bound. Bound to what? Bound to selfishness, bound to their own ways, bound to insecurities, bound to, you can be bound. But he says, he places them in families to bring them out of that bondage into prosperity. God really wants you to prosper. He really wants the best for you. But the rebellious, the rootless, they dwell in a dry land. And there's not much you can do about it. They prided themselves. And I think, you know, part of our American heritage is we kind of got that perverted because rugged individualism was a battle cry of the American people. And that can be a good thing, you know, because our nation was supposed to be a republic of the people, by the people, for the people. So that rugged individualism is a good thing, but if you're truly healthy, you can relate to other people too. You can maintain your uniqueness and your individuality and still function corporately without feeling that corporateness is a threat to your identity. So there's an appointed people, and God sets the solitary in families. He brings out of bondage into prosperity. The rebellious are not so. They stay rootless. Loners who care for themselves actually are spitting on the common good that God has for all. And Proverbs 18:1, a man who isolates himself seeks his own desire. He rages against all wise judgment. Here's another way of saying that in a different translation. Unfriendly people care only about themselves and they lash out at common sense. They will argue with it. I've watched it again on Facebook. Don't get your theology on Facebook. But on Facebook, I saw an article once where the guy was just talking about the Bible and that people really need to find a church, find a pastor, find somebody you can submit to. If you can't submit to that one, if you think he's a tyrant or a dictator, go somewhere else. Or if you think he's not a tyrant or a dictator, but he's so childish and irresponsible that he won't protect you. Because I was in those kind of churches to where there was a false grace. I can remember the worship team had some had their microphones up here, and one guy on the worship team didn't like, because he was left out of one particular one, so he took snips and cut the wires on everybody's microphone. That's called a felony. Huh? And you know, the pastor went, oh, well, let's not do nothing about it. You know what that did? That made everybody, he wasn't a tyrant. He was on the opposite end of the scale. He wasn't going to protect you either. He wasn't going to tell you the truth. He wasn't going to protect. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't feel safe. If the pastor wouldn't protect me in the sense of doing something in a disciplinary action. So there's two ends of the scale, but in reality, truth is always the tension between two extremes. We don't have an excuse. You need to have a pastor. You need to find a fellowship. And I'm telling you, we've got people that basically are saying, I don't know, I'm on Ustream, I do trust you. And if they make it a two-way relationship, in other words, I basically look for the financial commitment, because anybody can say, I'm hungry. Parasites are hungry. All right, but protégés, people worth developing, are willing to give it a two-way relationship, not a free ride. And when I see that even on Ustream, I see a connection that's valid. And these people, and I believe in the days ahead, these people that have quit going to church, some of them for legitimate reasons, but for the most part, they still have to deal with the internal woundings and offenses, because if you don't deal with that, you're never going to get back into relationship with people. You deal with the offenses, but I think God's going to do the micro, and he's going to do the house churches and the house schools, and it's going to be strong, and he's going to build that body back up to strength. You're going to have to know what to do, and you people have the tools. We do have the tools. That is our anointing on how to get people into full stature, no matter how long they've been in the church, how to deal with the woundings and get back on their own two feet and become functional. Functional as Sabbath sons and daughters that can enter into the rest of God and the walk of God without being burned out. We just saw an article, was that Ministries Magazine? Ministries Today Magazine. It goes out to pastors and leaders. It's put out by the same people that have Charisma Magazine. But 96% of the pastors are worn out. 96. You might as well say all of them.
Burned out.
Stressed out. Well, because I understand in part, I understand it, because even for us, this isn't what we do on Sunday for 2 hours and then nothing the rest of the week. It's like a business like anything else. There's paperwork, there's bookwork, there's overhead, there's repairs, there's equipment, there's, you know, there's other stuff to do. And I could see them getting busy in that. But for the most part, if they're getting burned down, it's people. They're trying to be Jesus. Rather than teaching them to rely on the Jesus in them and the priesthood of the believer and getting them to stand on their own two feet, you're not the source of grace for everybody in the room. You should be discipling people. I believe everybody should have a Paul. They should have someone that they can look to over them that they feel is going to be responsible to tell me the truth if I'm doing good or I'm not. Somebody that I can trust enough to ask them some hard questions. But everybody needs peer level friends on the same page to iron sharpening iron. And everybody, if you've been a believer, needs a Timothy. You should be discipling somebody, or you're basically doing nothing. Seriously. And you say, well, I'm taking care of my family. Unsaved people do that. You need to go beyond your natural family and be reaching out to the people around you. That's the other weakness in the church. The whole ministry is their family. But unsaved people do that. Unsaved people do that. So what are you doing that they're not doing? Don't tell me that was God's plan. That is not God's plan. All you do is take care of your family, and it keeps you busy. God's basically saying, I place the solitary in families. You need to ask God. It doesn't take the scripture to know that you have a natural family. It takes the scripture and spiritual reality to know who your spiritual family is. Do you know where you live? Do you know what you do for a living in the kingdom? Because if you can't answer those questions, you're still wandering. There is an appointed people. And the fourth one. And the fourth one is there is an appointed purpose, and that's exactly what we're entering into for 2016. There's an appointed purpose. Do you want to be part of what God's purpose is? I didn't pick the vision of the house. But the appointed purpose is that if you say this is home, and if you're watching by Ustream and you say, I'm connected, and many, many are. Before I even finished last week, there was tons of text messages on my phone even of people saying, that's me, that's me, that's me. So whether it's Missouri or California or North Dakota or Massachusetts or whatever, we've got sons and daughters that have house churches, they've got house groups, they've got house schools where they're teaching our material and reproducing and discipling people and helping people all around the world. Not to mention the 520 or 500 and some that are on the school. The online school takes dedication because, you can buy First Step Set, the book and everything, and go through a 60-day challenge. Online, they get additional videos, training, quizzes, and a final exam for everything they take. Even when we taught modules here, we would teach enough to know that they caught it. But in reality, I didn't know if they would really pass a test. Online school, the testing is there to see if they really do know. And that can be reproduced. As a matter of fact, before we can go any farther, because there are so many people outside of this building that have already connected, I'm going to pray for them right now. That Father, that you began that good work in Missouri, you're going to continue that good work, what Carol's doing in Missouri. That you would, that there's already a school using Live Free DVDs, and they're going through it, and people are changed lives. We're praying for Kevin and Noel in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and she's ministering to something like 20-some different women on a one-to-one basis. That's more like a house outreach. It could be a house church if the other people could change. We pray that your blessing would be upon them and their family. And little Alexander that sends me his tithe. I know where his heart's at. 5 years old, and he sends in a picture and a tithe. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that as far as heart commitment. And so, Father, we just thank you for that group. We thank you for Terry up in North Dakota and her group. That began this past previous Monday. I thank you for Brad and Carol, who have a house church in Maine. And we thank you, God, that you're even there going to be reproducing and causing more to flourish. I pray for, there's so many, I should have written these down. But all of them in South Korea, we're praying for that one. We're getting more and more contact from Canada and United Kingdom of people that are saying, we're taking this material and we're running with. We got to pray for Nelsie. Nelsie in Chicago, Illinois, has basically bought 30 books, and she's got 2,000 Spanish-speaking clientele. She took the module one in Spanish and is going to begin teaching it. And so, Father, pray for us too that we get some of our other stuff in Spanish, because there's a huge market for that. And thanks to Ricardo for translating those blue cards into Spanish and those modules. She's got 2,000 clients that she wants to minister to that are Spanish speaking, and Nelsie and her sister we met when we were in Israel, Matter of fact, she was calling and she was busy on the phone because she was ministering to other people. Ministering to other people, get out of your own life and look around and smell the flowers that you were called for a purpose and you should be helping other people. Who are you helping? Who are you discipling? We really got to get there. We really need an awakening. But the first thing that's going to happen in an awakening is you're going to see you've been sitting on your duff worrying about yourself. Where do I fit? Where do I belong? That is a sure sign that you are living in the cube of relativism. When you whine like that, you are exactly what Jesus said. This is spiritual insanity. Worrying about this and that as opposed to finding out what I'm saying. I understand that there's a disorientation when you're in transition. And it's not comfortable, but you've got to focus on saying, God, what are you doing in this mess? This is a real mess here. I just lost my job. I don't know where I'm going to go or what I'm going to do. Wow, God, how are you going to work this one out? I belong to you, and because I belong, you're going to take care of this mess. If you don't get back there, you're just going to shipwreck. No excuses. Let's intercede for that. that we dismantle all of your excuses. We're going to intercede and let the love of God flow out of Jennifer and I toward everyone in this building. And if you're a visitor, too bad, that counts you too. We're going to intercede that all your excuses are destroyed. Huh? I love that. Do you know that's the way the word works? All your excuses. I'm too old. I'm too young. I'm not smart enough. Everyone that whined in the Bible that you tried to use that excuse, God had one answer for them all. I am with you. And then they shut up. They quit whining. I'm too young. I'm too old. I can't speak. I gotta do this. Oh, shut up. I'm with you. That's what he's saying. I'm with you. If I'm with you, what's your point? I'm not asking you to do it. I'm asking you to cooperate. I'm asking you, what did we come up with this week, Jennifer, in our prayer time about the grace of yielding leads, empowers you, or it's the grace of empowerment that empowers you for obedience. You yield, you're empowered. Empowered how? To obey. You've got the easy part. God's supposed to do it. Apart from him, you can do nothing. All the lazy, self-absorbed people ought to like that part. It's God who is at work in you to will and to perform. All you got to do is get out of the way and let go of your stuff. All your plans and purposes and ideas that were not wrought in God, let it go. You were appointed for a purpose. I know the plans that I have for you. To love the Lord with all your heart, to love people. People? Oh, no. I love God, but it's these people. You're supposed to preach the remission of sin to everybody. You're supposed to make disciples. You're supposed to be obedient to the ministry of reconciliation. And you're to be committed to and further the family mission. We teach the family mission here. To what degree are you furthering that mission? You can further it by supporting it financially. You say, I'm not a preacher teacher. I don't have a home group. I don't do this. But you can financially support that. Everybody doesn't go on the mission field, but you can support it. And basically, we do something that's even different. We do the foreign missions ourselves, for the most part, Jennifer and I, in the days ahead. But what we're going to do is we're not going to support foreign missions. We're going to support in the country missions. Because when we did that, nobody supported us. But they would support people for a foreign mission.
But not stateside.
But stateside, you didn't have a meeting, you didn't eat. And I know the people that are doing our work stateside, those are the people I want to support because I can see clearly that they're discipling people. Not everybody that goes overseas is necessarily discipling people. Fortunately, we got quality missionaries in this church that have actually done it right. Matter of fact, everyone I know that's been a missionary in this church has done it right. But believe me, there's plenty that is just a vacation. It's ministry, not a vacation. And it's not the fun of seeing the world. If you really want to see the world, join the Navy. Join the military. They pay you to go see the world. And you grow up in the process, right? Oh, God, I can't speak. I am but a youth. I know that I get all the excuses. Father, right now, we just release intercession. Be forewarned. Jennifer and I this week are going to be interceding for this church to destroy your excuses. And some of you are masters at developing them because you know it worked. If it worked on your husband, it worked on your wife, it worked on your kids, you go, wow, that's a good excuse. Yeah, well, God's going to just start destroying those excuses, and he's going to call you on the carpet for service to him, to be about his story and his purposes. And here's the way that word's going to work. This is the way the Lord taught it to me out of Jeremiah 1. See, this day I've set you over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out, pull down, destroy, throw down in order to build and to plant. That's the way the word, even in the prophetic mouth of a prophet, that is the way it's supposed to work. And I think it's misunderstood that we just think that you say all the right answers all the time and it'll come to pass. I'm saying that that word has a way of working. And the first thing that it does is it roots out. That word is supposed to root out the sin in your heart. It's supposed to prepare the soil of the heart. So root out has to do with the soil of the heart. And part of what's got to be rooted out is some of your dependencies. Listen, if you're watching, don't send me nasty emails if you're a self-absorbed single person. But if you're a self-absorbed single person, what God might want to root you out is your comfort zone. And realize that part of the transition for your betterment is to root out of the comfort zone. If you're willing, blessing is on its way. Now he says, root out of your comfort zone, root out the excuses, root out the sin in your life. The second part is pull down. See, root out has to do with planting. You get rid of the weeds before you're going to plant something good. That's the way the word works. You don't just keep saying, take the promise box and pull out all the nice promises. We need a commandment box too, that to root out some of the other things. So root out has to do with the soil of the heart, rooting out the sin, rooting out the selfishness. Then it goes to building, pull down. When I looked up that word pull down, when I was a young Christian, I looked it up and I was just amazed at what the word of God coming from the mouth of the prophet is supposed to do. It's supposed to root out sin and selfishness, but it's also, that's the part before God can plant the word in them to really accomplish his purposes. But the next thing he does was in the building part is he roots out. And when I looked up root out, it says root out altars, family altars. Huh. Family altars and houses of thoughts. Ways of thinking that have run your life. But they're like strongholds. They're like a house of thoughts. They got to come tumbling down. They've got to be brought down and captive to the obedience of Christ. They're standing in the way. Your way of thinking can be standing in the way of Christ. So God was saying, family altars. That can be everything from worshiping your family over God. That could be worshiping me, myself, and I, bless us for and no more concept. That's easy with blood. But God's saying, I've called you to more than that. How about in some societies where family is literally lifted up to the point of idolatry to where they go into genealogies, correct? There's cultures where they go all the way back. The third one is destroy. When I looked up destroy, the scripture was reverting back to planting again. And it reminded me of weed and feed. The word coming from the prophetic voice should be now having rooted out the sin and prepared the soil of the heart. Now it should be destroying the heart. And this is a good destroy. Destroy the heart for evil to grow there. It's like weed and feed. It doesn't allow weeds to grow, but it nourishes the grass, the healthy stuff to grow. So to destroy means destroy the soil of your heart for evil. Destroy it to where it is so prepared that the word can go in and be planted. Then I looked, and it alternates in scripture. Hebrews do that a lot. In they would make things alternate like that. And the last one was throw down. Throw down, and we saw this when we were in Israel. Throw down actually means, just like the walls of Jericho laid flat, throw it down, lay all of that debris flat, take those house of thoughts, let them crumble, and we're going to build something beautiful in the kingdom on top of the foundation. Foundation upon foundation. Every time a conquering army went in to Israel and leveled it, they built on top of what they leveled. That was the previous foundation. And God's saying, I can take the compost pile of your mistakes and build a beautiful garden on top. I can plant, I can build on top of your mistakes. So don't sit there and wallow in your mistakes. Let me build something on it. In other words, even those that have made mistakes, I believe that God's saying, if you will turn those mistakes, repent and turn from those mistakes, I will build something beautiful and redemptive on top of that mistake. In other words, learn from your mistakes, do what is right from that time on. And God says, I can redeem it. I'm smart enough. God is really wise enough to fix our mistakes. But this is going to be a time, and here's the thus saith the Lord, and I'm going to close with this. But God's basically saying, Isaiah 61:4, this is what he's saying to Kingdom Life Church, Full Stature Ministries, and Team Embassy. Isaiah 61:4, and they will rebuild the old ruins. They'll raise up the former desolations, and they're going to repair the ruined cities and the desolations of many generations. Because there's a generational blessing coming, that when the altars of worshiping the generations is broken down, then I'm going to raise up, because God is generational in his function, and the things that were promised from generation to generation that were not necessarily fulfilled, there's going to be a generation that's going to fulfill it. Just like Solomon built the temple, David wanted to build a temple, but the next generation fulfilled the promises of God. God has got an ongoing generational blessing that's pouring forth, but you got to die to some of your generational garbage, generational sin, generational worship. And God's basically saying, get free from that and find out what God's doing and do as David did, who served the purposes of God for his generation. That's what the scripture says in Acts. David served the purposes of God for his generation. And that's what God's calling us to. So Father, right now, and I'll just speak to people on Ustream and YouTube, that know that they're part of us, and there's some that have known and haven't really defined it. But I believe the days ahead, we're going to define what the criteria is more completely. But basically, there's house schools, house churches, house outreaches, house groups that are going to be on fire for God to disciple and raise up the people. They're going to be discipling and discipling, whether it's one-on-one in a home church, home group, home school. But God says, I'm going to multiply my efforts as the waters cover the sea, and there's going to be small groups. And do not look at your numbers, because this is the time where I'm building strength. And it's like a huge net that's going to go around the world to capture and hold up great harvest that is about to come. And this harvest, every one of those little knots are like those little groups of two or more gathered together in my name. Two or more gathered together in my name. There's going to be upper rooms all around the world that are going to experience the presence of God, but they're also going to partake in the discipling of the nations. That God says, I'm giving you the nations, even this day, I'm giving you the nations. And God is basically going to arise in these areas, two or three. There's going to be successful mission endeavors that involve two and three people. Two and three people could change a world. It only takes one person to make a difference, and God can do more in a minute than you can do with all of your natural energy for hours and weeks and months and years. So Father, you who began this good work are going to continue this good work. And God, that Renewal 2016, I'm believing for 300. I'm believing that God says the strategy for the end times is going to be like Gideon. You will strike the enemy as one corporate man. And this one corporate man is not going to be a body of 300 people that are present. It's going to be 300 people around the world that are basically going to be ignited. They're going to smash those pitchers, and their torch is going to shine, and the enemy's going to be confused, because he's going to see little images of Jesus, corporate Jesus, is rising up out of believers all around the world where two or three are gathered in my name. There I'm going to be in the midst. But not only am I going to be in the midst, I'm going to magnify myself in the midst. I'm going to reveal myself to them, and they're going to walk in a sense of purpose and fulfillment and excitement. And I really think that this is the day where you're going to see the small units in the marketplace and in homes. And it's even a kind of return to the early church. And I also believe it's going to be a blending of Jew and Gentile in a new and a significant way that people have not seen before. There is going to be a new blending of the one new man that's going to take on a tangible appearance as God works together in this great harvest. There's a greater harvest of Jews and Muslims and Arabs than the world has ever seen is taking place even now in its beginning. And it's like a tsunami that's coming. And it's going to release the anointing and the blessings of God upon the nations. And we need to think in terms of the nations. Amen. Part of the way this is going to work, before you turn the camera off for the benefit of Ustream people, the way this is going to work is that I'm going to stay with these groups. I've seen two different kind of leaders. I've seen leaders that basically say, I don't want to put no control on you, but they also don't take responsibility for you either. That's a convenient way of dismissing you. But I'm going to stay in contact at least minimum. And if you need more, it's going to be more. Minimum of once a month with these little groups around the world by phone and email, but mostly by phone. I don't type. Email would take a long time. I answer, okay. Good. So phone is much better, and some of the people outside of the country can use Skype and get away reason. But I'm gonna troubleshoot. I'm gonna take the 40 years of ministry experience and help them in their small group overcome and troubleshoot. Because a lot of times the only thing wrong with a small group is sometimes one little minor problem can kind of throw a monkey wrench into its efficacy. And that's as easy as breathing for me. That's my benefit to the body. So I want to stay in contact with these groups, and I will mentor them personally by phone once a month. I know I've got house churches that I meet once a week. It can vary based on need. But it's going to be a two-way relationship, no one-way relationships. Two-way relationship is there's got to be commitment on their part, and there's got to be a discipling heart to be helping other people, not just, this would be good for me. Right? Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark.